So you talked about the building the plane while flying it. We have a vaccine that's come out faster than ever before. It's using a technology that's never been used in humans before, as far as I know, the mRNA kind of virus. So why don't you kind of walk us through what is an mRNA vaccine and how does it work?
Okay, let me jump backwards to something you just said there, though, real quick. The mRNA vaccines have been in human trials since 2013 for a variety of diseases: Zika, Ebola, influenza, cytomegalovirus, HIV. There's been trials for these strategies for a long time. There's one mRNA vaccine called Onpattro that is currently in use. It has been deregulated since 2018, and it's used for a very rare type of neuropathy, hereditary neuropathy. So it's a proven strategy that's been tested and evaluated for safety and efficacy now for at least 7 years in human trials. So let's start there. So what is it? When we look at how a cell works, you start with DNA, which is the master blueprint of the cell, locked away in the nucleus. It's very safe and secure, stable. And then when information is needed to do something, a photon of light, well, let's talk about an animal system. Let's just say you have DNA, all the information, that's your blueprint. Different parts of that blueprint are activated and turned on at different times. There are different parts of that blueprint that were active when you were a fetus that turned off and never turned on again. Other parts that are turning on now in your life that were never on before. Some that will happen when you're exposed to certain chemistry or maybe sugar or whatever. There's different parts of your chemistry that respond, your cells that respond. So when a gene turns on, the information in DNA is copied into something called RNA. And that RNA is a copy of what's there in the nucleus and safe with the DNA and travels out into the cell and travels out into the rest of the cell, where it connects with something called a ribosome, which is basically a machine inside your cells that takes the information in the RNA and makes a protein. So assembles a protein from amino acids based on the information in RNA. The best analogy is that DNA is the hard drive of your computer, locked in there. You never see it, hopefully. RNA is like the USB drive. It takes a little portion of that information and moves it somewhere else so that it can do work, like go to work where you can print out on a color printer, you know, that and that final product is your protein, for analogy. So mRNA is this unstable intermediate molecule that has the information from the DNA that allows it to make a protein. So how it works in a vaccine: the RNA is created to have the information for what's called the spike protein. It's a protein on the surface of the coronavirus. It's the little projections that make it look like the little spiky things that stick out. And that is the major surface that articulates with the cell through a specific receptor. So if you can block that with antibodies or develop an immune response against it, now all of a sudden you have a couple ways that you can defeat the virus. So what the mRNA vaccine is the genetic information for the spike protein that is injected into you. Your ribosomes, the machines of your cell, turn that RNA that's injected into the spike protein. And now your body puts out the spike protein, or, you know, it has the spike protein in it and recognizes it as foreign. It's like showing a wanted poster to your immune system. It's saying, here's who's coming. If he shows up, go get it. So it's a way of priming your defenses against the virus.
And so why is mRNA different from the other types of vaccines that are out there?
Well, the other vaccines mostly come from attenuated, or as they say, killed viruses, where they take viruses, they'll grow them up in eggs or in cell culture, and take that entire virus, polio virus, measles virus, whatever, take that virus and inactivate it using certain chemistries. There's a couple of compounds that you can use to do that, where basically the virus falls apart. Then they take those proteins and inject them into you. So your body is subjected to all the viral proteins that it mounts a immune response against. The big difference here is that here you're getting one protein, and it really gives the immune system a much more cohesive and specific target than all of the proteins from a virus, which aren't that many, but you're giving it a very discrete target. The other big advantage of mRNA vaccines is that companies can adjust what the vaccine is overnight. You also can make bucket loads of it real fast. And you don't have to change your infrastructure much to handle a new virus like you used to. Now you just synthesize a new RNA. Pretty easy.
And so what does it tell you that the process to get this approved and the whole regulatory process that had come before was not utilized in the same way? It was kind of reconstructed to do something. What does that tell you about the way our system was set up?
Well, the beauty of this is it shows that that things can be done on a much more expeditious time scale. In the old days, you had to go through many different levels of trials that were iterative. You did one, did the next, did the next, did the next. And it's expensive. It is failing most of the time. And so companies will, you take these things on one piece at a time because clinical trials are expensive, development's expensive. You take it on piece by piece. This particular situation, because of the crisis, because of the potential implications on the physical health of citizens as well as the economy, became let's do all of these things at the same time, simultaneously. And the government flooded money and $10 billion into different vaccine efforts through a variety of different companies, all using different modalities, with the hope that one would be good at 50%. And we're hitting home runs left and right. They've all gone through the same levels of scrutiny, the same levels of testing, but just done it one time in 1 year rather than dragging it out over 10 years.
And do you think that ultimately the system that we use needs to be updated? Like, should mostly like our drug system go much faster, be put through this way? Or is it, no, just for this scenario, we need to leave it this way?
Well, it's easy for me to say because, you know, I'm not writing the checks for the company and you know, but I do think that we can go faster. It shows we can go faster. And right now we are in an explosive time for cures, for diseases that we can beat. There are mRNA vaccines against specific cancers, all kinds of new tricks that are being done with gene editing to target what have previously been terminal cancers, gliomas and advanced ovarian cancer. You can almost cure that stuff. In some cases, either cure it or give people significantly, well, I shouldn't say people, give mice specifically much longer quality of life. All of these things can accelerate to human trials and human application faster if we had a different system. And I'd love to see that.
And so when you think about a technology that's only been around for 7 years, This doesn't frighten you? This doesn't have an impact on you that says, you know, I only get one life, and if I inject something in that messes me up, that's it, game over.
Yeah, it doesn't frighten me at all. To the opposite, it gives me more confidence because and this is why, and it's kind of interesting, if you were giving me something that was an order of magnitude more complicated, I might have pause. You know, we're trying this new next gen edgy technology that is a real derivation of many different things we've done before. I might kind of think twice, but this is actually going backwards. This is taking what we've always done, what's always worked, and made it simpler. It's made it a much more basic, traceable, understandable, process that now you're only tracing one protein and its effects, its ability to control immunological response, to characterize immune response to one protein instead of a whole series of them. This is why it's so powerful.
Thanks for checking out this podcast short. If you like this interview, make sure you hit the like and subscribe button and hit that bell so you always get notified about this podcast. And if you're really interested in conversations like this, you may want to consider joining the Articulate Ventures Network. To find out more, go to network.articulate.ventures.